The desk. My name is Cora, and I'm joined by the only caster with longer hair than mine. It is Soddle. Soddle, we have had quite a day so far, but you know what? I'm excited to see more play.
I'm excited to just get to finish casting a game. That would be an achievement for me at this point. We've just seen games going to game four over and over again, and just falling a little bit short of getting that climax that we needed. But hopefully this one will be as exciting as those games were shaping up to be. We have Nostum versus Lemurian.
Nostum coming in second place in the America's Winter Championship, just falling short of booking his ticket to BlizzCon. Certainly he has a lot on the line here. Lemurian, somebody we haven't seen nearly as much of. He is an open tournament player, reasonably popular on ladder as well, but has not had a big finish. So certainly a lot on the line for both of these guys.
Yeah, definitely. Lemurian has had some streamed exposure in some ESL Legendary Series tournaments, for example, but definitely looking for a big breakout. And as we keep hammering the point home, this is the biggest stage of them all. You know, this is the official Blizzard sanctioned format. This is Hearthstone Championship Tour. And if you are going to try and make a push to get yourself a spot and get your real big break as a pro player, this season is the last chance that you're going to have unless you're hanging on for one of those last call spots.
Yeah, very high stakes for both guys. Nostum does have a shot at the last call spot, but yep. Lemurian, this is pretty much it for him. And as we can see from the screen, both guys have gone ahead and banned Shaman. What do you think about leaving the Warriors up?
It's definitely an interesting decision. They are both Dragon Warriors, which if we, throughout the last 2 months solid of tournament play, we've seen Dragon Warrior being banned with remarkable consistency in just about everything. But what I will say is that Lemurian has Questing Adventurer Rogue in his lineup. And one of the decks that any type of Miracle Rogue is weakest to is just Aggro Shaman. Whereas it can be a bit more effective against Dragon Warrior. Dragon Warrior can still get the job done with the aggression, but it doesn't have that all-out, you know, balls-to-the-wall aggression that Aggro Shaman does. So, I mean, Questing Adventurer Rogue is very, very well positioned. I was talking to TJ, and TJ said that it's one of the highest win rate decks in competitive play at the moment. So it might be he's just looking to maximize the power of his Rogue and getting rid of the Shaman because he doesn't want to deal with 16 points of damage from Doomhammer.
I don't think anybody really wants to, but the Questing Rogue has also recently gotten a bit of a boost on ladder due to Barn, who unfortunately is not available to be played in this tournament, so it's a little bit unfortunate for Lemurian, but like you said, it does have an excellent win rate regardless, and we're going to be able to see it right here in the first match. Lemurian is going to be bringing his Questing Adventurer Rogue versus Nostum's Yogg Druid with Wisps of the Old Gods.
Double Wisps of the Old Gods. As you saw, he mulliganed away and got one back. He does have that all-important Wild Growth in his hand, and this matchup has kind of been classically decided in kind of the same way since the beginning of time, which is, you know, come turn five, turn six or so in the game, who really has initiative on the board, right? Has the Rogue been able to get off a big prep play with an Azure Drake or a Violet Teacher? Have they been able to stabilize long enough to really go off with Gajazan? Or has the Druid flooded ahead far too hard and just gained too much mana, generated too many threats for the Rogue to deal with?
And in Lemurian's mulligan, we actually just saw him toss it away. Conceal is a card that has been played in Rogue for a very long time now, but has been sort of cycled out. And with the addition of the Questing Adventurer, right, it also works with the Gadgets and Auctioneer. So we are going to be seeing a couple of those in Lemurian's list today. So Nostum does pick up that Wild Growth on turn one. Certainly a practiced Druid player, very skilled indeed. But Lemurian's hand is also looking pretty decent. He's got Edwin Van Cleef, which if he picks up prep, he does have the coin, could possibly get out a nice large Edwin early on in the game, push for some damage.
Yeah, Edwin is definitely one of the huge cards in this matchup. Druid doesn't really have great ways of dealing with just a huge idiot on the board. Like, they generally just play one mulch in their deck, and that's about the only way they have of removing just a lot of stats from play. So if you are able to generate a huge minion early, that can be a huge advantage for you. And Nostum is not quite hitting the mid-game tempo he'll want here. He can start developing next turn with Druid the Claw, but those double Wisps in his hand are going to take a little while to get value here. But if he can combine one with the Soul of the Forest, which won't be too difficult because he's going to Emperor discount his whole hand at some point, that's going to be a nightmare for the Rogue to remove.
Yeah, his 5-8 plays are looking really nice, but Nostum does always have to be worried because the Rogue just has Fan of Knives. I mean, if you're going to counter Wisps of the Old Gods with any guard, Fan of Knives is going to do it you know, pretty much the easiest out of any. So he's going to want to be able to play the Wisps on the same turn as the Soul of the Forest to avoid, you know, getting just his board completely wiped. He does have both copies in hand, though.
I love this play from Nostum, choosing to charge the Druid of the Claw into the 5-4, which might seem like a counterintuitive play to some
players.
But Miracle Rogue is a similar deck to kind of Tempo Mage, which is in the sense that if you don't let them keep things on their board, it's very, very hard for them to, like, leverage a platform to beat you. If you just place stats into their existing minions, that's what they want you to do, right? Because all their cards beat stats. So if you just keep one-for-one removing their minions throughout the mid-game, you can buy yourself time to do some pretty gross, powerful things like combine Wisps of the Old Gods and Soul of the Forest in the same turn.
Yeah, and had Nostum left that Tomb Pillager on board, Lemurian had the option to play Coin along with Sap and Edwin Van Cleef, which would have been, I mean, that would have been quite a swing turn for him. So definitely the right choice from Nostum to go ahead and clear off that Tomb Pillager. And now he gets down his Emperor Tharizon, gets some nice reductions.
Certainly does, and it's all important because his hand is looking incredibly clunky right now. The Wrath being discounted might be nice just to cycle it into a better card at some point. Zero mana Raven Idol is always a bonus, and like I said, you made the point that Wisps of the Old Gods can't really just be slammed on the board against Rogue Roar. It's going to get banned away most of the time, but if you're able to find the mana to just put Soul of the Forest on it in the same turn, that can be greatly beneficial to your game plan, so I imagine that's something we will see Nostum try and do this game.
Now, I'm really interested, what do you think about the addition of Journey Below into the Rogue deck? It's something that we've seen in the N'Zoth Miracle variant.
Yep.
It's definitely a nice addition into the Rogue class, but how do you feel about it in this deck?
So, it's a cheap spell. It's a one-mana spell that you can use instead of Deadly Poison. That's generally the slot it goes in. They could take the Deadly Poisons down to one and play Journey Below instead. And when you're not including Blade Flurry in your deck anymore, you lose a lot of the value from Deadly Poison. Particularly in the questing deck, you know, it's a one-mana card that you can play that buffs your questing and puts another card in your hand that you can then play again. So, you know, I've seen plays with this deck where you'll just play Journey Below and just take the cheapest minion without even looking which one it is just to buff up the questing. So I think it makes a lot of sense in this deck.
And in some cases, that cheap minion might be something like a Blood Mage Thalnos,
sure,
a Loot Hoarder.
Right.
Anything to help you cycle through your deck. Spell damage is always useful, so the Death Rattles definitely can't be overlooked. Lemurian picking up that Questing Adventurer, which is somewhat of a backbone in this deck. Without Leroy Jenkins, you need some way to burst down your opponent, and with the addition of Conceal and Cold Blood, Questing Adventurer is a really nice way to do it.
This turn is actually just a little bit disgusting. He's going to start building up his Questing Adventurer, and he can drop a huge Edwin, and he can conceal his board. That's kind of absurd.
I would say that's pretty good. And Zeral Poison Mind, also a really nice card in this list because it gives you two more one-mana spells to use.
Yeah, I don't think there's any decision to be made here. Lemurian just taking his time to not reveal that he got a premium card off the Journey Below there, but Zeral pretty much exactly what he wants in this situation. Coin, Edwin, Conceal, your turn, friend. I'm quite happy with how my turn went. Now it's your turn.
How can Nostum come back from this? Lemurian is going to have, goodness gracious, he plays the Deadly Poison, the preparation. I mean, he is really just going
full on.
That is a
14-14 Edwin Van Cleef.
And a 9-9 Questing Adventurer. Nostum looks thrilled, doesn't he? Just so happy about this. And that draw is great. So great. That's just represented lethal on board, and there is nothing that Nostum can do about it. He can Power of the Wild for a minion, Wrath his own minion for one damage, and attempt to draw
Feral Rage.
Something.
Which, yeah, at that point you're like, okay, well, I'm not dead, but, you know,
but I'm still really dead.
Which cards in your deck do damage? Oh, all cards in your deck do damage because you have a Questing Adventurer on the board. Yeah, that's probably a problem.
And like you said before, this Druid deck only runs one mulch, so it's not like he could top deck two hard removals. So Lemurian is going to take game one on the back of his Questing Adventurer Rogue. Nostum just not having a good enough hand there. He had the Wild Growth, he had a little bit of ramp, and then the Emperor discounts, but I mean, my goodness, that last turn from Lemurian was a thing of beauty. It really was.
Yeah.
I liked it.
If there was a tier list of Hearthstone turns that I have watched in my time as a Hearthstone player, that would definitely be towards the top.
That'd be up there.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It'd be a comfortable S tier.
It really makes you believe all of the Rogue players that say Rogue is so great, because, I mean, that was just That was phenomenal.
Yeah, because that happens
that
every, that happens
that
every single
great.
Game, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Every single time.
Oh,
yeah.
Absolutely. If you're skilled enough, of course.
Yeah.
But that is going to put Lemurian up 1-0. His Rogue is now off the table, and he has to win with the Warrior and the Druid. Nostum still has to pick up a win with his Yogg Druid, the Warlock, and the Warrior as well. You know, I, for one, am not unhappy that we're not going to be seeing Shamans today, at least in this match. There's going to be plenty more Shamans, but right now...
it's like,
right,
at least, that is at a Korra promise. No more Shamans this entire day. If you see another Shaman on stream, tweet at Korra and...
Please don't.
Okay.
Oh, please don't. No, but at least for this next, you know, couple of games.
Sure.
Shaman-free zone. It's no mana, no 4-mana 7-7s. It's just nice to see something different.
Is no one playing Eerie Statue? Is that not happening?
Huh. Well, Purify hasn't been released yet. Mm. Only two people in the tournament brought Priest, so I'm going to have to say no to Eerie Statue, which is a little bit disappointing, but the Rogue is off the table, so that's pretty much the only unique class here. I believe we may be a little bit surprised by Nostum's Warlock, however, so that could be interesting as well. But going into game number two, here's the Warlock, and it is a Renolock variant versus Lemurian's Yogg Druid.
It is, and it's something that I've been seeing a little bit, this particular variant being the Nuzzoth version, as you can see, but I know, obviously, not one of Nostum's biggest practice partners is Chucky, and Chucky himself has said that he feels Zoo is a little bit overrated in the meta currently, and he's chosen to bring a slightly different lineup himself, so it's no huge surprise to me to see that mentality kind of bleeding through the circle of friends that surrounds Chucky. So, well, I'm not sure how happy I am painting Chucky as the center of that universe, but we'll move on quickly.
Hey, Chucky's earned some recognition. He's had a great year so far.
He certainly has. He's a fantastic player, and
absolutely.
I love him. But yeah, Lemurian's going with the Yogg Druid this time, having picked up the win with his questing Rogue. And again, this is a matchup where, similar to what Nostum was trying to do from the other side, Lemurian is going to be wanting curving out his chunky mid-game minions. He's going to be wanting to be playing his four drops down early, and making sure he's solidly ahead on tempo in the mid-game, because this isn't a game that you're just going to win by just getting a few minions down and being aggressive. You're really going to have to try and stick a board and use your big value tools like your Violet Teachers and Fandral to really just generate awkward board states that Renolock just doesn't really have the consistent removal to deal with most of the time.
Yeah, the Renolock does have Hellfire, Shadow Flame, and Twisting Nether, but it always seems like when you need them, they're just never in your hand at that right moment.
Right.
So if Lemurian can capitalize on that, it's going to be the push that he really needs to finish this game early, or, you know, very quickly after the Reno Jackson hits the board.
Yeah, it's just kind of the nature of the deck where you play these three big AoEs with the intention that they're kind of proxies for each other, right? So I can only play one of these cards, but all three of these will do similar jobs. But it's just not really the case, because smart opponents will make plays that are only weak to one of them specifically, and in which case your actual odds of just having that one specific card, as is the nature of a Reno deck, is pretty low. So Yogg Druid, pretty talented at being able to manipulate the board in a way that, you know, can present one big target that is resistant to a Hellfire or Shadow Flame, along with some tokens where suddenly they say, all right, well, I've just spent, you know, 6 mana on making this huge board. If you have to spend 4 on Hellfiring it and I still keep my Violet Teacher, then great. So.
All right, Lemurian is going to go ahead and innervate out that Nourish. He's had a couple of decent Raven Idols already, did pick up the Wild Growth to put him ahead on mana, and does decide to go for the 3 cards instead of for the mana ramp again.
Yeah, interesting decision. I've heard a lot of debate, honestly, about what it's correct to do with Nourish in that situation, because Lemurian is playing a pretty big deck, honestly. He has Onyxia, 2 Wisps of the Old Gods. Although saying that, he has no Ancient of Wars, so his deck's actually not that big. He's playing 2 Druid of the Claws in the spots where other people would be playing big threats. So with that in mind, he probably doesn't have consistent enough use for just lots of mana to be able to just blindly slam it and trust that his deck was going to draw him gas. So I like him drawing cards and trying to pull together his combo pieces at this point.
Yeah, his existing hand wasn't good enough. There was nothing that he really wanted to ramp to. I mean, Starfire's not exciting at this point. So he definitely valued drawing more minions, drawing more gas, instead of just, you know, ramping up and then potentially drawing nothing.
Having now drawn cards, he does have most of his powerful combo tools available to him, but nothing that looks quite perfect on this turn, so it looks like we're just going to see a Wild Growth here to give himself access for more mana on following turns, and then he can really start to do pretty gross things starting next turn.
Yeah, the Violet Teacher, Fandral, Power of the Wild, I mean, there's just so many possible disgusting plays in there, as long with the Wrath as well. So he's definitely, if he can pick up that second Innervate, is going to have a lot of different lines of play. Nostum just sort of playing to his curve. He gets the Harvest Golem out. He ends up with the Earthen Ring Farseer. Heals back up to 29, which is nice. And does have Nazoth in hand, but no other Death Rattle so far.
Yeah, I like seeing him tap every turn as well at the moment. This is what drawing Reno early kind of does to you. You know you have the security to just keep life tapping every turn. There's no way you're going to put yourself in too awkward a position that Reno can't dig you out of. But the first power play of proceedings from the Yogg-Druid has come into play here. And this is based on Lemurian's deck with, you know, all the refills. He plays, you know, the two Teachers, the two Wisps of the Old Gods, and Onyxia and Yogg-Saron. This could very much be a game of attrition for Lemurian, where he just makes one huge board state after the other over and over again until hopefully his opponent runs out of AoE options and finally, you know, Onyxia gets to stick at the end.
Yeah, and especially since Nostum has that Cult Apothecary in hand, he's going to have so much potential for heal and then apparently the board clears that he's got as well. So yeah. Lemurian is just sort of going to keep having to, you know, take the initiative, push a board out, and then Nostum is always going to be in this reactive position until Lemurian perhaps, you know, misses a single turn, and then Nostum later on in the game can go ahead and play Nazoth or, you know, Reno Jackson. He's got Karen Bloodhoof, which is really nice for, you know, maintaining a board state after your opponent potentially clears your board. So he does have options, but it's going to be a long game.
It is, yeah. I mean, Co-Apothecary can definitely stall, but if you're not addressing the board in the same turn, like say your opponent plays Onyxia and then you just slam Co-Apothecary into it, you're going to die to Savage Roar regardless if you can't clear the board, no matter how much it heals you for. So, you know, Co-Apothecary will be great to stall, but he's going to need to like pair it with a Shadow Flame, for example, a lot of the time. So Lemurian will probably be ruining that Spellbreaker a little bit, because the first time he pushed with the Violet Teacher there, like, I was going to say best case scenario, but best case scenario, there was no answer and he just started jamming face. But, you know, he would have thought, okay, this will be AoE number one gone now, and then I can start moving again. But the Spellbreaker kind of changed the equation to the point where it was a sufficient answer to the board, but it keeps all the AoE resources back in Nostum's deck, still waiting for so many refills that are available to Lemurian here.
It is actually important to note that although Lemurian is playing two copies of Wisps of the Old Gods, he does not have Soul of the Forest in his deck. What? So Nostum was playing Soul of the Forest, and if Lemurian were to play Wisps of the Old Gods, Nostum has access to that Demon Wrath in hand, so that's an easy clear on that 7-cost card.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what's interesting is that Nostum was playing basically all the finishes. He was playing Soul of the Forest and 2 Savage Roar in his list, whereas Lemurian still has the 2 Savage Roar, but no Soul of the Forest, so they are both fairly well set to leverage any reasonable size board that sticks. But yeah, Soul of the Forest is a great card for the reason that we almost saw in the previous game before it got carried away with Questing Adventurer, where you can just, it's a win condition that can be played in a single turn with a Token Flood, right? You can slam a board and then Soul of the Forest it all in the same turn, and then that's almost job done already. Whereas Savage Roar requires one of your boards to stick before it gets any kind of value.
All right, so Lemurian has made his second big board push, that second Violet Teacher. And Nostum has plenty of options to remove it. He can simply go face and play Twisting Nether, which it looks like that's what he's leaning towards. The Demon Wrath is also available to him. It would have left up a 3-1 Silence Violet Teacher. Not too big of a deal, but the Twisting Nether is just an easier clear all around.
Well, there is the Savage Roar. And yeah, I like this decision from Nostum to use the Twisting Nether here, because mentally, you know, he has full knowledge of the deck list. So mentally, he will be earmarking certain things for certain situations, right? And in this particular situation, he knows that there are 2 Wisps of the Old Gods that can be played here, in which case he'd much rather have a Demon Wrath in his hand than a Twisting Nether. But what he doesn't have in his hand is a Ragnaros the Fire Lord.
But what he does have is a Silver Hand Regent.
I mean,
isn't that
fair
great?
Fair trade, personally.
Oh my goodness, talk about an annoying card to burn. Maybe not going to come in too handy in this matchup, in general, right. But just to have the option of an 8-8 body that deals 8 damage immediately, even though the Lemurian's likely to have a lot of tokens, is still something you want in your hand over this 3-3.
Yeah, I mean, I like the idea from Lemurian to burn a card there. Try and burn a key card like Reno Jackson, like the Hellfire or the Shadow Flame that we haven't seen yet, because suddenly you're then in a very, very powerful position. But yeah, no such luck. The Ragnaros, while it looks intimidating, it's not the kind of card that's going to get a great deal of value against a deck that just tries to play a million 1/1s every turn, right? Like, Rag is just not a particularly high-value card. But still, I like the idea of what he went for there, and he kind of pushed all in with his Wisps, but perfect answer with the Demon Wrath from Nostum.
Yeah, Nostum does not have any more board clears in hand, but Lemurian doesn't have any way to push on board either. He does not have the second Wisps of the Old Gods right now. The Fandral plus the Power of the Wild is nice. It forces Nostum to find some other way to clear off that Fandral. Otherwise, he would have to trade both on board, but it's not looking good for Lemurian. Yeah, Nostum just has too many answers.
I didn't feel like your heart was in that one. It's like,
I tried, it's fine, sure. I tried to give him a little bit of an upswing, make it seem more even than it is, but Nostum's just, he's pulled so far ahead here. Now he has access to Nazoth the Corruptor. After this Sylvanas dies, he'll pull back a Harvest Golem, a Cairn, and a Sylvanas, and at that point it's just, I mean, Lemurian could draw Yogg, so I guess it's never really over.
This is indeed what is known in the industry as a Yogg game. Unfortunately, the old caster meme of, wow, what if he draws Deathwing? Like, that's dead. But now there is actually a real thing that happens, which is, he might just draw Yogg and win the game. That seems fine. Like, even if there's a Sylvanas on the board, Yogg can still beat Sylvanas. Just first spell, entomb the Sylvanas, and then you go off. Like, it's fine.
Or silence the Sylvanas, right, and then play Twisting Nether,
We
got all these options.
Everything is fine.
Kill everything except the Sylvanas, play Freezing Trap.
Boom. See, now you're thinking with Yogg.
It's all possible with Yogg-Saron. And Nostum is going to go ahead and put out the other, I would say, more liked old god. Nazoth, generally well-received. It doesn't make you happy to see it, but definitely doesn't quite enrage you as much when your opponent plays it as Yogg-Saron. Lemurian is going to answer with Onyxia.
This board is just incredibly pay to
legendary.
Win right now. Yeah,
there is just
much going on here, but the Onyxia probably not quite going to be good enough. With Nostum short of having lethal here, he will do his due diligence on Savage Roar, but I'm sure at the end we're probably just going to see the maximum trades done here, because even playing around something as niche as double Savage Roar in this situation is not the worst thing in the world, because it seems to be pretty much the only way you lose in this situation, right?
Well, Nostum can play Cult Apothecary, go back up to 30 health, and then just trade away.
Yeah, I mean, the big game Hunter comes down on the Onyxia, and then it's just a matter of Savage Roar maths, right? Like, you have to trade to a certain extent just to play safe around what you can, but at the same time, you'll need to make sure that he's setting up his own lethal on the next turn. So with these three whelps on the board, each Savage Roar would add 8 damage, which would be 16, 19. So even like another swipe or Druid of the Claw on top of that isn't even going to get the job done. So this seems just about perfect, and that looks like it's going to be GG.
Oh, man. What a difference the game would have been if Lemurian had had that Soul of the Forest at some point. It would have given him the board resilience that he needed past Nostum's board clears and potentially have given him a way to combo those Savage Roars. But in this case, just not enough. And Lemurian is going to go on the clear plan. Ah, man. I mean, he doesn't have any other way to survive, but at the same time, he doesn't have any way to win.
Yeah, and this is not the highest value Emperor Thorasan you've ever seen in your life. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Like, Soul of the Forest looks like it could have been pretty strong in this matchup, because he's had that Innovate in his hand the whole time, which means that, for example, the Whisper of the Old Gods that he had, he could have combined that with Soul of the Forest in the same turn using the Innovate. So Soul of the Forest definitely a card that is was almost a joke for large periods of Hearthstone's time. It's considered one of the worst cards in the game, and now suddenly here we are talking about how great it is.
Sogoth the Slitherer.
Yep.
Not necessary here, but it's nice that he got an invitation to the party right before Nostum ended the game.
Not necessary, but incredibly stylish. And that's what matters deep down, is style points.
You know what's even more stylish, Sottle? Nostum finished this game at 30 health and did not ever have to play Reno Jackson.
Damn.
That's stylish.
That is stylish.
And this is what we expect from the America's Winter Championship first runner-up, and hopefully Nostum wanting to come back and you know, assure his position at BlizzCon by going to the Summer Championship and, you know, taking it all. And it is 1-1, so he does still have quite a bit of a battle to get there, but it's looking better for him. He was able to take that game.
It is, yeah. And Nostum, I think, proved a lot of people wrong in his run through the Americas Championship. He was kind of considered, you know, a bit of a memer, a player of wacky decks. He wasn't really treated too seriously as a competitive player, and he really proved his worth in that tournament by getting so deep and getting to the finals. But, you know, as far as BlizzCon is concerned, you know, first runner-up is just the highest placing loser. Like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't get you anywhere. So if he wants to get back to BlizzCon, he's going to need to either make the run through this tournament or take his spot in the last call. So everything is on the line for Nostum here, but like you said, able to tie back up this series, puts himself back in good shape.
Seems like a very subtle mentality. If you're not first, you're last. In this case.
Is that not factually accurate?
Ricky Bobby mentality. But in this case, I think it works out quite well. Oh, you're so British. It's okay. Don't worry about it. But Nostum,
I know who Ricky Bobby is.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Good. Then we're both on the same page.
All right, good.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Right.
And Nostum and Lemurian, both on the same page. One win apiece, but it is best of five conquest. Someone's got to win three games.
Sure.
One of these guys, I would assume.
One of these guys, yeah, most likely. But like, it's tough. I mean, Yogdruid is showing, and it's showing its weaknesses a little bit so far, I think. And it's Chucky, again, in his analysis for this tournament, said that Yogdruid was potentially the weak point in a lot of people's lineups, and it's starting to appear that that might be true based on the representation that we're seeing so far.
Yeah, both players have lost with that Yogdruid so far. The Rogue taking that first win, and now, I mean, they're both going to have to win with them, but we're going to go into the Warrior Mirror, which is something that I don't think we saw at all last week at the European Preliminary, seeing as Warrior was just so commonly banned. But this week, I mean, it's happening. Shaman instead got the bans.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird that, like, Dragon Warrior is somehow a refreshing new deck in this tournament, but it's kind of true, because like you said, even though Dragon Warrior was one of the most common decks in terms of lineups in Europe, it was just banned consistently in every single series, more or less. So we just really haven't seen too much of it here, and this is going to be a Dragon Warrior mirror, which is honestly just a very snowball-y matchup. Mm-hmm. There is not a huge amount of play in it compared to a lot of different matchups, because it's just generally going to be who gets on board early and snowballs to an advantage. But Nostum definitely has a bigger, greedier list, packing in Onyxia and Deathwing at the top of his curve. So he is prepared to go longer than Lemurian in this game. So Lemurian, the initiative is going to be on him to try and snowball that early board lead.
Yeah, almost as different as two Dragon Warrior decks can be from each other. Lemurian taking a much more aggressive route with that Nezoth's first mate, and then Nostum, a much more high-end heavy list. Mm-hmm. And Nostum is going to have not an easy choice here with this Finley. Generally, you want to, though his deck is still a little bit more control-based, you still want that steady shot. You want Shapeshift. Fire Blast is okay. In this case, he goes with the Rogue Hero Power. It's not terrible, but it's certainly not what he was hoping for.
Yeah, I mean, above all else, I think, like, Life Tap is just king with Dragon Warrior a lot of the time. You just want to make sure that you're drawing resources as effectively as you can. But that draw of the Alexstrasza champion is a pretty big deal, because he had no real other play that contested that 3-1 effectively. Nezoth's first mate just seemed terrible. Fairy Dragon would have just got chewed up by a dagger alongside the 1-3. So Alexstrasza's champion is a huge, huge deal. And Nostum is going to suck it up and decide that he has no better play this turn than to turn his Ravaging Ghoul face up in his hand.
I mean, this is all right. If Lemurian goes ahead and plays the Fairy Dragon, then Nostum will just clear the board and put down a 3-3, take board control. But we're thinking Lemurian, I mean, Nostum has telegraphed pretty much that he has a Ravaging Ghoul, or that he's got nothing and he's going for the two-turn dagger to the Alexstrasza's champion plan.
Yeah, I'm not sure the plan is ever take 9 from an Alexstrasza's champion and expect to win the game. I don't know.
Inner Rage coming into Nostum's hand. That's interesting, considering it is, you know, somewhat of a more late game Dragon Warrior, and we're seeing the inclusion of a bit of a more aggressive card.
Yeah, it still adds some damage and increases how quickly you can use Grommash as a win condition. And it's also, you can just make great tempo plays to ping off minions. This deck can struggle to do one damage sometimes if you don't pick up a hero power like Nostum has. And also, you just get great tempo with Azir Drake sometimes, just Drake in a rage of two health minions. So it's not a card that I personally favor in the lists, but I'm pretty sure Nostum knows what he's doing, what he's trying to target with the deck, and in a rage is a card that he feels worth a spot in his deck.
Now Nostum's hand, he does pick up that Fairy Dragon, which gives him something to do this turn, but Lemurian's curve is fantastic.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got that Draconid Crusher in hand, which will activate the Blackwing Corruptor, and now the Twilight Guardian, the second Twilight Guardian. It's sort of an embarrassment of riches for him.
That is one way of putting it, yeah. And these Blackwing Corruptors are going to be insane for tempo here, just swinging the board every single turn. And all the while that Nostum is being forced into using his face here for removal, which he managed to bypass that turn using the Execute, but very, very quickly, he is going to run out of ways to prevent himself taking damage to face, and then suddenly with one Execute gone, that 9-9 Draconid Crusher is going to come down and potentially just seal the game right out.
Yeah, being forced to use the Rogue Hero power to take more damage to his face is just, you know, helping Lemurian out even further with his own Draconid, putting Nostum's health down even lower. The Inner Rage does come in handy. He's able to trade off and put down his own 6-6, so he's managing to keep board control and keep board advantage, but he's only got two cards in hand. Lemurian has five and picks up an Azure Drake, which cycles.
Yeah, I mean, that Inner Rage is actually incredible. I mean, I said personally that I'm not a huge fan of Inner Rage in this deck, but I think literally any other card in his hand there, and he probably would have lost this game. Mm-hmm. That was the only card possible in this deck that could create this level of a swing on the board. You know, Cruel Taskmaster would have been too expensive. Any other removal spell would have been too expensive. He needed specifically a zero mana card to help him tempo out there, and he's managed to reverse the board state to now, all of a sudden, there's just a 6-6 on the board that Lemurian can't deal with, and now Nostum has all the initiative, but never mind, because that is an execute.
One of two in his deck, and the only card that he could draw off of that Azure Drake to clear off that Draconid Crusher. That is some fortune right there. That's some good luck.
What we just saw is the complexion of the game changed twice in the course of one single turn passing back and forwards. The Inner Rage flipped the game completely, made Lemurian look like he was in real trouble, but then the Execute draw changed it right back to the point where he now has complete initiative playing onto this board.
Lemurian has 5 damage. He could go ahead and drop Nostum to 17, not enough to activate the Draconid. So playing the Corruptor and clearing off the Drake, just a more solid play. He picks up the second execute.
That second execute might come in handy very, very shortly, because we are going to have an Onyxia in his future if Nostum can at least stabilize to the point where he's not being threatened with lethal. And if Lemurian's draws this game or anything to go by, we are going to see a Ravaging Ghoul drawn immediately on the turn after that Onyxia comes down.
Oh my goodness, that would just be absolutely perfect. Well, nope, there it is. Oh. Soddle, has anybody ever told you you're psychic?
No.
Well, they've never told me. Consider me the first.
They've never told me, but I can see it in their minds that they're thinking it. So.
Yeah, that is what psychics do.
That is the definition of psychic.
The definition. Lemurian just some incredible top decking skills here, and he's going to go ahead and just add more to his board. And Nostum, he does have Onyxia, but he's also only at 14 health. So can he even afford to play it is the question.
Yeah, it's kind of a damned if you do, damned if you don't scenario. I think if he doesn't try and generate the board position here with Onyxia, if he's given the opportunity to do so, not just facing lethal on board, which he would be if the Corcron goes face, then if he has the opportunity to play Onyxia and he doesn't draw something spectacular, I think it's the only reasonable play he can make with any expectation of winning the game. Of course, we're going to see that it's just going to be absolutely game losing, but I'm sure unless there is something absolutely insane here that we're just going to see Onyxia come down.
I mean, there's no better play.
Yep.
You imagine that an 8-8 and a board full of 1-1 whelps, not bad. In Lemurian's case, he just has the absolute perfect counter to it, and he's going to go ahead and completely wipe this board. Can even throw down the Alexstrasza's champion, deal another free damage to face.
Sorry, as a man that is a fan and a bit of a connoisseur of wry smiles, that was a mighty fine wry smile from Nostum right there.
The picturesque epitome of a wry smile.
Yeah.
You know what? Nostum has been in worse situations before. He's had to come back from, you know, he's clearly unhappy. Mm-hmm. But he's not out of it yet.
Nope.
It's still only going to be two wins for Lemurian. And, oh, man, that Deathwing.
Yeah,
would
I was going to say.
Nice.
I didn't want to cut you off. I was like, literally, this is one scenario where what if he draws Deathwing would have actually been valid.
But what if he drew Yogg-Saron?
Right.
Which he didn't have in the deck.
He was one card off. Deathwing came a card too late. Both executes were gone as well, which meant that Deathwing could potentially carry on the board. You saw Lemurian hold back the Alexstrasza's champion as well, just because, like, well, I only lose to Deathwing here. Like, why would I commit another card, right? So, unfortunately, one card late for Nostum, and that was just a brutal draw from Lemurian, honestly. He curved out perfectly. He hit execute exactly when he needed to. Then he picked up his Ravaging Ghoul in time to counter the threat of the Onyxia. So, that was a very, very messy game from Nostum's side.
Had Nostum been able to curve out as well, he would have won in the later game. He did have more of the later drops, the Deathwing, the Onyxia. So, in theory, had he drawn well, he could have actually been favored in that game. But unfortunately for him, just, you know, Blood to Ichor, Inner Rage, Execute in the opening hand, plus Onyxia, not what he wanted to see there. Lemurian is going to take that game and bring this match up to 2-1 over Nostum. Lemurian just leaving with his Yogg-Druid, and Nostum, the Yogg-Druid and that Dragon Warrior that just did not perform for him in that last game.
Yeah, and what I will say about the list is, like, when you put more greedy cards like Onyxia and, you know, extra Draconid Crusher, I think Lemurian is only playing one Draconid Crusher in his deck. So when you're putting all that extra late game in your deck, you're going to draw some of that late game, right? You're entitled to do that. You're going to curve out less consistently. So Lemurian, honestly, if you want to phrase it that way, got rewarded for just building his deck with a lower curve, and that he was consistently establishing himself as the aggressor. And Nostum just kind of got stuck with an Onyxia in his hand that he just couldn't play until it was way too late.
Yeah, Nostum's list, definitely more of a high risk, high reward.
Sure.
All right, and it's going to be the Druid Mirror match. Lemurian on game point. If he's able to take this mirror, then he will win the match and advance in the winner's bracket. But Nostum's got the Wild Growth, so it's still anybody's game.
Yeah, Nostum does have the Wild Growth. He also has the Fandral to go with it. Lemurian choosing to keep Raven Idol, which is always a decision that interests me. There's a debate on whether or not keeping Raven Idol is correct, because you have decent odds of hitting an Innovate or a Wild Growth with the Raven Idol, but you can also try and mulligan it into a Wild Growth or Innovate by just throwing it back into your deck, and it can still come back later. Raven Idol into Raven Idol. Sure, nothing particularly appealing there. Let's just rebuy it. We can try again later.
Infinite Raven Idols. It did work out for Lemurian in his last Yogg-Druid game. He did Raven Idol into Wild Growth on turn two.
Yep.
Unfortunately, did not work as well for him this turn, and Nostum has a very nice curve.
I actually would personally hold on to the Living Roots here. This matchup isn't really about damage. It's not like a be aggressive, go rush you down kind of matchup. It's very much a mid-game board control matchup, and then there's kind of like an end-game table flip where someone has to try and Yogg to get back into the game, whoever's lost board control. So Living Roots as a tool in your hand that you can use to combine with Violet Teacher or Fandral or Azure Drake is more valuable than just having 2-1-1s on the board most of the time. So I would actually like to see Nostum pass here. Nostum disagrees, he's going to play the 1-1s.
You know, I can understand wanting to get that board pressure early on, even though it's only 2-1-1 saplings, but you are putting yourself in a position where if Lemurian were to play, you know, for instance, Power of the Wild for a 3-2 minion, I don't know why he would do that, but it would put you in a position to perhaps make some favorable trades for yourself. Lemurian does manage to pick up the Wild Growth this time, and Nostum has one of his own, so Living Roots is going to be 2 damage to face, but he doesn't get to keep it for the utility later on to combo with the other cards.
Yeah, what I will say is that Nostum's deck, in fact, both of these decks are double Savage Roar lists, which of course makes being aggressive and playing for damage more noteworthy. But still, I mean, he has Fandral right there in his hand for a starter. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the combo potential of that Living Roots was definitely there in the future. But he, by doing it this way, he's kind of created almost the same scenario. It's just the Living Roots have got stuck in for four in the meantime. So we'll see how this works out for him, whether this early chip damage is actually relevant over the course of the game.
Wow, and Nostum chooses to just play the Fandral, does not coin out Raven Idol because he's assuming that on five mana, Lemurian won't have swipe plus a hero power, but Lemurian draws Living Roots and can actually clear off this entire board if he so chooses.
What? He can also just mulch as well. Like, swipe Living Roots isn't necessarily required because this isn't an Ancient of War deck, right? There's no there's no huge threats in there. There's the Onyxia, which is going to be a huge problem, but, you know, Fandral and Violet Teacher are pretty much pretty high on the list in terms of things that you have to mulch, but oh my god!
Wow.
Oh,
I would almost say you're wishing you kept that mulch, but...
I mean, sure. Let's not get carried away here. This play is probably stronger since he can actually curve through into the 7-8 next turn if he wants to, whereas the Earth Elemental would overload him for too much. But I don't think there is a better feeling in Hearthstone where you get a mid-range or a small minion mulched against Druid, and you just get a bomb in your hand. Like, you just get, like, Ragnaros or something. Like,
so used to getting Lowly Squire or, you know, Silverhand Regent, like we saw last time. But
right.
Earth Elemental, that's quite a card to get off of mulch, and that will definitely work for Nostum's favor because Lemurian only did have that one mulch in his deck. So Nostum, already ahead on board, is able to just further push this advantage. Does have some options this turn, however. He's got the Earth Elemental, the Druid of the Claw, can coin for a hero power if he wants to clear off that second sapling, or you can just throw down 6/1s.
Nah, we're making wisps. That's what we're doing. This is interesting because, I mean, I agree with your initial assessment of that Fandral turn, which is like he wasn't scared of swipe that turn. So it's not really like in his mind that he's tested for swipe, right? Like, he doesn't really have an established read that there's no swipe in hand. So potentially getting his whole 7-mana turn there punished by 4 mana definitely feels like a risk in terms of tempo swing that he didn't really need to take. But I think this Earth Elemental is just going to be so strong.
Yeah,
with the mulch gone.
Fortunately for him, he was already, you know, further ahead. So Lemurian didn't have anything to go with the swipe on his turn, and now Nostum's just going to be able to reestablish that board and, you know, picks up another Wisps. Didn't work out the first time. Why not try it again?
I'm just wondering, does Lemurian play Sylvanas in his Druid list? It would seem strange in this kind of tokeny list. It's generally in the more ramp heavy. I'm just trying to think of reasons why you wouldn't want to just jam Earth Elemental on these last couple of turns. Like, sure, it interrupts your curve, but the last turn was fine. He could have, at the turn that he chose to Wisps of the Old Gods, he could have played the Earth Elemental and still had a coin 5 play on the next turn as well. So, all right. Interesting decisions, but this Wisps of the Old Gods board has been generated, but Nostum is just going to say, you know what, my Wisps might not be quite as big as yours, but I have the Savage Roar to back it up, and you may not. So we will see how this one works out for you.
Nostum decides to trade the Druid of the Claw into one of the 2/2s, hedging his bets against Savage Roar here. Yep. He already knows that if Lemurian has Savage Roar, that is an incredible amount of damage on board, so might as well cut it down by 2 if he can. And fortunately for him, Lemurian does not have it. He does, however, have that second Power of the Wild.
And I actually think that is a huge deal because, and I think Lemurian can work this out as well, because generating a board of 1/1s into this board of 2/2s just looks absolutely awful, right? Like, you'd look at your opponent and say, well, why would you ever do that? The reason that you can quite easily arrive at as to why you do that is because, oh, he wants to swipe my board next turn after he's made all these trades. So suddenly that extra Power of the Wild that then makes your opponent need a spell damage swipe to be able to do that effect looks like it could be potentially game winning in the long term here.
And unless these decks are running Azure Drakes, which in Lemurian's case we can see he is not, or Mage Thalnos, which is incredibly uncommon. The spell damage swipe is not something that we're going to be seeing, really. So Lemurian decides to go ahead and charge the Druid of the Claw, play the Power of the Wild, and he's going to go ahead and most likely just get these 1/1s off the board. He's in such a dominant position. You don't want any possibility that you can lose to something like double Savage Roar.
That is the world's longest rope. I've literally never seen a rope last that long before in my life. But yeah, of course you have to trade there to play around all the potential burst damage, as well as Soul of the Forest just potentially locking out the game. And the misery swipe has to come out here from Nostum. This was obviously his plan all along, but it's just not going to be good enough. And this Earth Elemental, I can't help but feel that this should have been on the board several turns ago.
Lemurian's eyes got so big when the Earth Elemental came down, and I feel like if it had just been, you know, three turns ago when he had that option to curve from Earth Elemental into Druid of the Claw, it would have put Lemurian in a position where maybe he couldn't have possibly come back from it. But now the board has switched so decisively in his favor that the Earth Elemental, while still good, it's just not good enough anymore.
Lemurian's just sat here like, please show me the Savage Roar. He still has one more draw at this Savage Roar. It's not going to be lethal, I don't think, or is it? He would have five. No, he'd still have to trade two in now, especially since he can't use the hero power. So he's not going to have enough damage to go through. So he is ruining his lack of Savage Roar right now. And that means this Earth Elemental is going to get to pick up significant value. And since Lemurian dedicated so much of his mana that turn to digging for that Savage Roar, he actually has no pressure to follow this up now.
Oh my goodness, could this be potentially another board swing? Nostum doesn't have much in his hand, but he does have that Nourish to draw for more and the potential to combo perhaps a Violent Teacher with that Soul of the Forest. Unfortunately for him, he is overloaded for three, which really limits his options.
So Raven Idol going to come out here. He is going to look for a removal spell, but since he's not going to generate any pressure of his own here, the initiative is going to pass all the way back to Lemurian, who, in terms of his hand, the dream scenario for Lemurian right now is give me an empty board to develop threats on. Like, that's just what I would love to do in this position. So unless Nostum can find some way to seize the tempo this turn, which I just don't think is really possible, Lemurian is still going to be in a solid position. And remember, still two Savage Roars sat in his deck that could come out and finish this game very quickly.
Yeah, very fortunate for Lemurian there that Nostum didn't have anything to follow up with. And Raven Idol only giving him a Wild Growth, essentially a three-mana cycle. Just not what he wanted to see there, but you can't pick Astral Communion. So Nostum does pick up that second Wisps, but he's unable to play both the Wisps and the Soul of the Forest on the same turn even now, because he doesn't have an Innervate or any discounts.
Yep, and this is exactly the scenario that we just talked about, and that is Fandral, Innervate, Wisps of the Old Gods, one of the most powerful plays this deck can make. Wisps of the Old Gods has an alternate option. You've only seen it being used to generate 1/1s on the board, but it can also be used as a +2/+2 buff effect. And there you see it being done at both at the same time due to the effect of Fandral, and that is just too much power for any man to handle. A god can handle it, but that god is not in Nostum's hand.
No, it is not. And Lemurian is going to take that match 3-1 over Nostum on the back of his token druid. Phenomenal results for him, and just really a very, you know, swingy game in general. The board did shift presence several times, several turns in a row, and we thought with that Earth Elemental that Nostum did have a chance to take it, but unfortunate for him, maybe, you know, not playing it early enough, perhaps just some unfortunate draws. But however it did end up, Lemurian is going to take that match and move on in the winner's bracket. Nostum will be dropping to the lower bracket, making his road to the Summer Championships all that much harder.
Yeah, a long road ahead for Nostum now if he wants to return to a second championship. But Yogdruid, the big story of that series, I think one or two players are starting to say that Yogdruid is a little bit weak in the format right now. And the only game that Yogdruid won in that series was against another Yogdruid. So potentially accurate. Is Chucky right? You decide.
All right, we're going to go ahead and throw it over to Frodan at the blackboard to see what he has to say.
Congratulations to Lemurian as he moves on to survive yet another round. Unfortunate for Nostum as he does drop to the lower bracket, but we can still see him around perhaps next time. We can see him kind of shovel it up together. I think even his practice group members, Admirable actually practiced a lot with Nostum, and he was just saying, like, he's much better than this. He doesn't have to fall to like that, but it happens. And I think Nostum's proved that he's pretty consistent. He got 9th place in 2 qualifiers back-to-back, so perhaps he can make another deep run.
And even managed to make it to one of those because one of the players in the first the Winter of Championship could not make it, so he ended up getting 2nd place there to Amnesiac.
Let's take a look at the list of players. Not only has some been eliminated on the bracket, but there's a lot more happening in the bigger picture. You can see that we have a lot of locations in the U.S. West. We do have a couple of these players eliminated, Killin' All Day and Ants. These are 2 players who have known to contribute a little bit to the pro scene with some of their decks and guides.
Yeah, Bradford Lee, one of the competitors from last championship. LBYS, Cora's pick fell in already. It's Protohype, a pretty well-known name, unfortunately, also fell in the Knoxville area.
That's right, over in the U.S. East. VLPS, a good friend of mine, actually did end up falling, and he's a player that was on the upswing for some time. He's going to have to come back next year for a chance.
Impact, a pretty well-known player, and Talion, both unfortunately did fall already from the Canada region. Latin America, Leo Main, a favorite of many of us here at the casting desk. Correa, one of the players from the 2015 America's Championship. Unfortunately, their run ends here.
That's right. And of course, we do have some Tavern Heroes still alive. But a few have been eliminated. We pointed out the Rat earlier in the day. He, unfortunately, has been eliminated. But we still have Timma still around, and he's a really good buddy of mine. We have Arizona Fireside being shown right now. This is the people that showed up to play in the preliminary. And you can see that some people are just taking some time sharing. Some people are there hanging out. Some people are there competing as well. So a good mixture, and it seems kind of fun. A lot more people than this empty tavern with just a few casters.
It's really cool that these are locations that only the players can go and meet other competitors, but they're also open to the public. So people can come and meet some of their favorite players, sure. Watch them, you know, play their games, and just have a good time playing Hearthstone, watching Hearthstone.
That's right. So a little bit of updates on the board. As you guys can see, some of the fan favorites, Zalay and Dog and Firebat, still going on strong. We do want to update you on a couple of others as well. Phone Tap in the upper bracket is going to be moving on. Vanquisher, pick from TJ, ends up getting eliminated, though. So we do have to strike some names, which will be fun. I unfortunately don't have the time to do it because we're ready for our next match. But come next time on the Blackboard segment, we're going to be crossing some names off. So stay tuned, guys. Our next match is happening right now. Let's go back to the desk.